Abraham Lincoln was portrayed in the historical movie of 2013 by the same name. Of course, since it is played by an actor, we can't say this representation exactly depicts the man as he was for real, but there are many examples from the actor where he is leading successfully people's minds and opinions during a difficult war context where many political forces were against him.
What I carry within me, you must allow me to do it. Alone, as I must, and you alone, Mary, you alone, may lighten this burden or render it intolerable.
Indeed, the movie talks about the abolition of slavery, and we are going to study the communication maneuvers that made him get the last word more than one time without using any threatenings or physical force of any sort. Obviously, it can be difficult to argue against anybody else in a political setup where people share different values and different opinions, and where some people are determined to make you fall from your position, but he's able to lead the frame, to own the frame, in more than one situation, mostly using two things we are going to dissect in this video. The first one is some brilliant use of storytelling, and the second one is a trickier, it is called a pattern interrupt, where in many instances he is leading people with the help of some nonverbal behavior. One doesn't go without the other though, because in order to be able to interrupt people's thoughts and arguments in the blink of an eye just like that, it requires to have already established a positive image and an image of somebody that people legitimately like, at least most people like from the outside. To make that simple to understand, if somebody is constantly or like 70% of the time talking in a harsh, authoritative, raising the voice nonstop and yelling at people, and only 30% of the time that person is nice and gentle, at some point nobody is listening anymore, and when that person is trying to yell, well, everybody is not listening anymore anyway. But on the reverse, if the person is polite, gentle, compassionate most of the time, and only a few moments, and you have met people like this, only a few moments that person is raising the voice or getting a bit aggressive, there you're fucking going to listen, because you're not used to it. It is a pattern interrupt in that context.
Waiting. He engineered the fortress himself. The damn thing's his child. He'll defend it till his every last man is gone. He is not...
Come on out, you old rat!
That's what Ethan Allen called out to the commander of Fort Ticonderoga in 1776. Come on out, you old rat! Of course, there are only 40-odd redcoats at Ticonderoga, but... It was right after the revolution, right after peace had been concluded. And Ethan Allen went to London to help our new country conduct his business with the king. He was invited to the townhouse of a great English lord. Mr. Allen found he needed the privy. Now, Mr. Allen discovered on entering the water closet that the only decoration therein was a portrait of George Washington. His host and the others were disappointed when he didn't mention Washington's portrait. And finally, his lordship couldn't resist and asked Mr. Allen had he noticed it, the picture of Washington. He had. George Washington's likeness in a water closet? Yes, said Mr. Allen, where it'll do good service. The whole world knows nothing to make an Englishman shit quicker than the sight of George Washington. I love that story.
The main benefit of using a story to make a point instead of trying to argue about the very point directly, frontally, brutally with some people, the benefit of that is that you can pose their trail of thoughts without having, again, to use any threatenings or trying to push people angrily. You just start the story and their mind shut down, because the conscious mind can't stand not knowing. When you start a story, the first thing the mind of people listening is obsessed with is, where is he going to lead that to? I need to understand what is the end, the point of that story, before I can understand how to react to it. In this context, what he's trying to do in this dramatic political climate where there is a war happening outside and they are discussing military facts in this scene, he's trying at least to make people find resources again, calming down the situation and helping the people around to find resources with some injecting some humor from the best he can to try to make them think more clearly again. On the opposite, in situations like that, usually people only react in anger, in fear, which is normal. So it is kind of difficult to own an entire room like that, and I do not know how real that scene is, if it was really like that back then with him, I do not know. At least it is a great scene in the movie. You can see in that scene only one guy doesn't want to listen, only one guy out of an entire room, so he still owned the frame in that entire context. And now we are going to get more deeply into pattern interrupts. So what does it mean, first of all, and how can you create one the way he does in those examples? Again, you first need to have established an overall positive image in the mind of the people regularly listening to you. If you only have the image of a debilitating, a brutal person who doesn't let anyone speak, nothing of what you say then will be acting as a pattern interrupt. But once you have accomplished the outcome of establishing in the minds of your listeners the image of somebody respectful, kind, compassionate, somebody respecting other people around, once you have grounded that image from you in the mind of people listening, then any harsh behavior will cut short any disagreement. Anyone. Because it is a shock. Anything that creates a shock in the conversation, something that is abnormal compared to the first trail of actions in the conversation, will potentially create a pattern interrupt that will prevent everyone else from arguing against you, at least for a short period of time, which can be enough to make your most important point and potentially get people's opinions back on your side.
I have to do this, and I will do it, and I don't need your permission to enlist.
That same speech has been made by how many sons, how many fathers since the war began? I don't need your damn permission, you miserable old goat. I'm going to enlist anyhow. And what wouldn't those numberless fathers have given to be able to say to their sons, as I now say to mine, I'm commander-in-chief. So in point of fact, without my permission, you ain't enlisting in nothing, nowhere, young man.
That first small example was happening during a scene where his son wants to be enrolled in the army, wants to go to the war, and Lincoln in that movie has already lost another son during the war. So this is, he's heavily reluctant, and he's here interrupting his son with a gesture. Again, that kind of gesture won't work if you are just always aggressive and always trying to push people, that won't work. But when you are calm, collected, you think clearly, you talk in a smooth way, and then suddenly you interrupt by getting closer to the person and literally doing a gesture like this, it's an interruption. Gestures like that are an interruption. If I put my hand on your face right here, and if I kind of violate your personal space, because I go inside your personal space close to you, that is an interruption for the mind, especially if you have never seen me doing that before. Unfortunately, I can't let the sound in this example because it is not allowed by YouTube, because it is a famous scene, but basically they all argue against him because he apparently lied into some declarations according to the political problems down there, and he's patiently listening to all of them without really reacting, so he just let them use all their anger at him, and at some point he's smashing his hand on the table, and that shuts down everyone, but he speaks very slowly, very calmly, and he says, I can't accomplish anything until we cure ourselves of slavery. And then he raises the voice again, starting to get a little more aggressive in his tempo and tonality, which is acting as an even better pattern interrupt when you switch the vocal tonalities like that while advancing important arguments. This one is a perfect example of the kind of shock introduced or induced by some brutal change of behavior in the conversation. Since an interruption is always based on a shock compared to what happened in the conversation so far, or what people are used to with your behaviors, with the way you communicate usually, anything you do that is going out of your natural ways of interacting will pose people's thinking and make them listen to you much more carefully. And in the end, you may not even need that much outrageously clever ever arguments in a context like this, because getting people's attention is often more important than how thought out your arguments are. If the person does not listen to you, you can be Milton Erickson, that doesn't do shit, no one will change, or no one will reflect upon themselves in deeper ways, or no one will reevaluate their thought process or their opinion about the matter at hand. But if you can get their attention first, then even simple arguments can go by. But you need to get them to shut down their inner critic first and then fully listen to you. That is why pattern interrupts are so powerful in communication.
This is Mr. Ashley. I have to say, Mr. Lincoln, that could you please just step outside?
You gonna have a chat now with the whole of the House of Representatives waiting on this?
Making false representation to Congress is...
It's impeachable. I've made no such false representation.
But there are. There is a delegation from Richmond.
Give me the note, Johnny. Please deliver that to Mr. Ashley.
And this one was, in my opinion, the most brilliant example of flexibility in a conversation. How can you be flexible enough so that the people stop resisting what you say? Because trying to confront somebody head to head is often leading to one of you getting injured, if not both of you at the same time. The rule to bypass those problems in modern communication tactics is to never ever resist what you hear, only accept it and redirect. Only accept and redirect, never resist. And you see such a great example of that right here. The first guy doesn't want to proceed with the command. Fine, thank you. You, do it. And if you don't want, you, sir, last one, do it. Just remain flexible. Just because the first thing you do in an argument or the first thing you say doesn't work out, that doesn't mean you should stay forcing and forcing and forcing on this. You can just move on to another move, another way of saying the things you wanted to say, another way of explaining your ideas. There is always one way people will respond to positively and some ways people won't respond to positively. It's not about being right or being wrong. It's about how long can you remain flexible so that even the people who were resisting at first won't be able to resist anymore because you have been more flexible than they could be. It is also acting as a kind of interruption, not as brutal as the other ones, but a kind of interruption here, because the way he is behaving, if you watch carefully and listen carefully, the way he is behaving with the first guy who doesn't want to get the letter, he's behaving in a way that is presupposing non-verbally from his voice and the soft attitude he has, it is presupposing that he agrees and that he is going to maybe write something else on the letter that will more be inclined to be accepted by the person who was supposed to bring the letter back into the court. But he's not doing that. He's presupposing he's doing that by his behavior. Oh yeah, of course, get me back the letter. But at the same time, he's keeping the same behavior and giving the letter to somebody else who is less likely to resist. And at the same time, he holds the hand of the person. That was a move that called in my mind a memory of when I was a magician. We used to do that when you have a spectator who is really annoying in the audience and always wants to prevent you from finishing your tricks, whatever. At some point, giving that person something in his hands to keep him busy, or tell him, don't go run away with that, I will need that later. Just giving something in his hands will make him shut down a lot of critics, or make him do something, just calculate some numbers, whatever. It is allowing him to shut down and let the magician proceed with the rest of the audience. It kind of reminded me that from the way that scene was shown. And on a slight side note, if you are interested in that type of stuff, I think the greatest expert on that on earth is Danny D'Ortis, that I had the chance to meet in 2012, not long before that movie came out. And that guy is probably the best expert ever on kind of manipulating your mind into thinking you made a choice of your own, but you did not. He made you choose what he wanted you to choose. And then you're like, how is this trick possible? Well, it is possible because he made you choose what he wanted you to choose from the first place. But that is another story. Now, if you want to develop your skills with communication, how to bypass resistance, how to create interruptions in the right way without disrespecting people either, and how to make sure you command respect and earn attention without being brutal, you have a document down below in the description called The 7 Steps to Master Sleight of Mouth. It is a document I wrote, I think, like 1 year ago. I think it is a good introduction to how can you develop better conversational skills and how can you get people's attention so that they will be much less likely to disagree with anything you say. And they may even also change their mind, their beliefs, if you are in a therapeutic context where you want to help others get better. You can read that if you want, and in the meantime, I will say you goodbye and see you soon in the next video. Thank you for watching.